As Angular developers, we use ngif and ng4 all the time. But how does structural directives actually work? In this video, we are going to build our own Angular structural directive. I will also dive into the so-called Angular microsyntax. Structural directives are responsible for adding, removing, or manipulating certain parts of the DOM. In this video, I want to create the directive ng-repeat, which will repeat a piece of Angular template a number of times. I know that the ng is the Angular prefix that you should not use, but this is because I want to emphasize that Angular's own structural directives work the same way. Let's first look at the template syntax. I create a simple paragraph and put the structural directive on it with the name ng-repeat. Note the asterisk sign. This is just syntactic sugar for the following regular template syntax. The content, read within a ng template tag, with the directive applied to it. Let's add the directive to prove that. Let's change the prefix. Now, as you can see, nothing is rendered by default. That is because an ng template should be rendered explicitly. How do we do that? First, we have to get the template ref, which is the reference to the template element. We have to get it injected like this. And as you can see, it requires a generic type. I will show you why in a few minutes. For now, let's just use any. Now let's add an ng-onInit method to render the template. To do that, we also need a view container ref. You can see it as a reference to the place where the directive is located in the view. We can now use the create embedded view method to render our template ref. And there it is. Let's render it 3 times. As you can see, both syntaxes do the same. Now, let's add an input to make the directive more configurable. In microsyntax, you can add an input like this. And as you can see, it sees that an input ng-repeat cannot be found. What actually happens is that this binding was added like this. So let's add the input binding in our directive. And you can now see why an input alias can be useful. Now let's use a for loop to render it the specified number of times. Now when I change the input value, you will see that it does exactly what we expected. We can make it more dynamic by adding a text box where we can specify the amount of repeating. Let's state that the default value is 5. So I have an ng model. Refer to variable. Now as you can see, things still work, but nothing happens when I change the value. And that is because we had to use ng-onChanges in our directive instead of ng-onInit. This method is called whenever an input binding has been changed. Now we have an issue where the template is rendered too many times, and that is because on every change we have to clear the view container ref first. Now I want to explain template context. In most cases you want to render the ng-template in a certain context. For example, in our case, we want to know the current index like this. To make this possible, we can pass an additional context object when creating each view. Each template can be associated with a specific context. So let's pass a context with an index set to the local variable I. Now we have to get the index from the context, and in microsyntax you can do it with the let keyword. And in this case we define a template input variable I, which is assigned to the index property of the context. And let's do the same with regular syntax. And here we have to use the prefix let. Now that we have successfully used a context for our directive, let's add an interface as well. Let's call it repeat template context with an index property which is a number. Now you can use this interface as the generic type for our template ref, and this will make things more type safe. You have seen that template input variables are associated explicitly with a specific property of the context, in this case index. There is also a way of making it more implicit. We replace the index property with $implicit. We have to change this in our interface as well. We can simplify things in our template. I can now remove the association with index and things work the same. Now we are using an implicit context value. We can improve our microsyntax by moving the template input variable to the beginning of the expression. And the rule is that it should be separated by a word to your preference. In this case, the word in. And as you can see, Angular will use this word as a suffix and treat the next part of the expression as a binding. Of course, this is quite some magic, but it makes the microsyntax very easy to read. So the last thing I want to show you is how you can have multiple inputs. Let's say that we want to configure a start and an end of the range, and let's call it min and max in our app. I can still use microsyntax. I just have to separate each binding with a word, and each word will be included in the binding name. So let's update our input bindings. So now that we have updated our bindings, we can update the for loop to use the two bindings. As you can see, things now work as expected. I hope you guys liked this video. Please subscribe and thank you for watching.